Tractate in the Rim, page 72, 13 lines from the top of the page. Tashma nadra vehi arusa v'nitgarsha v'nitarsa bo bayom. We learn two concepts. One is called hafara and one is called kiyum. Meaning, we explained in the past several days, there are different status of a minor girl. From the beginning until the bat mitzvah, she is under the domain of the father, meaning any matter of commitment, of vow, the father can either approve or annul. From that point, between 12 to 12 and 6 months, she is na'ara, she is in between, still under the domain of the father, and then she is bogeret, 12 and a half years old, she reaches her age of adulthood, and then she is, in a sense, independent. But if she betrothed to someone while she is in that age, in between, and then she divorced, so here you have a special status. This status is called arusa. Remember this word because I'm going to use it constantly. And arusa meaning betrothed, and betrothed meaning there is a stages, especially in those days, the erusin, meaning the matter of betrothed, it's already a form of commitment, even it wasn't a physical relation, but it's already a form of marriage commitment. And you have here two sensitive entities involved with her life, which is her father and her husband. And the question is, does each of them independently can annul, ratified her vows, especially certain vows that they didn't hear about, such as if she made a vow privately without their presence, can they go ahead and ratify it? Can they annul this type of vow? Now, they purposely use here as a circumstance that appear rare, but we can derive from that the logic way of thinking. Is basically the same way as the syllogism in the critical thinking. You use the most severe hypothetical scenario, and then you derive from that the basic foundation of understanding. So here you have the arus. Again, remember, I'm going to use this word a lot. So arus, meaning the engagee, is not a groom, but is not just another guy. He is her fiancé. So the arus, he gave her a get after she commit herself to certain vow. So basically the question is that kiyum haneder? Is that mean that her vow is in effect? Or you say that it's like shtika, like if he was acquiesce, if he display equanimity, it means that he accepted that. So here you see a mishnah based on what we learn on page 71. Nadra, if she took a vow while she was betrothed, she was arusa, and then she divorced, and then she betrothed that day to another person, so afilu leme'a, he will use the term even to 100. 100 is basically a language of a pure exaggeration, but the idea is, the great Rav Natanzon explained in his book, we're using this term for a purpose. Soon you see 100 days. It's based on Gemara in Yevamot, we study, if you remember, that if someone nitarsa, if she is betrothed and then she divorced, so she needs to wait a little more than 3 months. Why is that? You remember? It's because maybe she's pregnant, right? And you want to make sure that, so here she divorced and married the same day. So in general, kofin alav legarsha, you enforce him to divorce her because it's during that period. But in the same day, meaning that the father heard that same day. Avio ubala ha'acharon mefirim nedareah. Here you have a combination, as we studied in the past several days. You have a combination of the father and the husband. Together, they ratified her vow, shma mina, you derive from that. Geirushin kishtika dame, you treated the matter of divorce as a matter of being acquiesced. The E is like silence, expression of silence. You're sitting at a meeting and you kept silent. What is the interpretation? That you basically acquiesce. The Ika Kamadamu, if you tell me that the matter of the divorce is considering as approval, Mi Matzei Mefer Arus Acharon Nidrei De'okim Arus Rishon. She engaged to someone, right? She betrothed to someone. And she made a vow. And the first engagee, the first fiancé, approved it. And now she have another one. And does this guy can annul, can he abrogate a vow that the other guy approved earlier? Okay? So because the language of Mishnah that they used, she betrothed and then she divorced Bo Bayom, that day we derive for that the father or the husband heard about her vow, and now we understand that since the father heard the one said, for sure he can ratify that day. But here you have this situation. Again, let's make sure that everyone understands. You have a young girl, let's call her name, Tamar. She betrothed to Reuven. She commit a vow. She made a vow. Reuven approved it. Okay? Then she divorced him and she betrothed to Shimon. Does Shimon can have the power to have a retroactive act as her fiancé to abrogate it, a vow that Reuven already approved? Okay? So, hacha b'maya skinan, the Gemara rejected that and said, here, what we are speaking about, b'shelo shama arus harishon. You know what you're talking here? You're talking about situation that the first betrothed, he didn't hear about it. So if he didn't hear, so the matter of divorce, the betrothal, so the matter of divorce from the first guy is considering as hakama, as approval. But if the first one did not divorce her after he heard that, so the matter of divorce is considering the same as approval, hakama. And therefore, the second guy who come afterward cannot retroactively annul the one that was already approved by the first guy. If you tell me that the betrother did not hear the vow, my iria bobayom, why the Mishnah needs to zoom in and tell us that all that hypothetical circumstance happened that day, meaning that she divorced and betrothed that day. Afilu lachar me'ayamim name, even they pass 100 days too, meaning the father and the husband can annul her vow. So as we said, you remember the concept of 100, as Rav Natanson explained, it's because based on the Gemara in Evamot that we said that have to exceed it 3 months after the divorced. So the Gemara said, "Kshelo shama arus," meaning the first husband did not hear the vow. "Veshama ha'av," however, the father heard that. So therefore, the Mishnah speaks about situation that she divorced and betrothed that day to someone else. The vovayom who the matzei meifer, which means together the father and the husband, he can abrogate it. Aval mikan va'eilach lo matzei meifer. But from here to the forward, he, once her father has already heard the vow, her betrothed cannot nullify it on a different day. So one cannot infer from the Mishnah that divorce is like silence. We should know that there is a disputation among Rishonim, among the early rabbis, in a concept of Bo Bayom, that particular day. Because the big question is, you meant to say that both entities, which is the father and the betrayer, need to hear it that day? You meant to say together? You meant to say that day separately? Or you even meant to say that each of them need to hear it in maybe different days? So it's a disputation among the early rabbis, what does that mean? But in general, as Ran explained, if the father heard her vow, the father and the last man that she engaged, they can annul it only if all of that happened that day. Tashma, we learn from Mishnah in the next chapter, page 89, Nadra bo bayom, gersha vechazira bo bayom. So here was a situation that she made a vow that day. Then they divorced. And then returning happened that day. En yachol afer. He cannot change it. He cannot nullify the vow. Okay, the reason for that is because it's not been ratified by divorce, but because the reason for that is because they said here, Shma mina gerushin ka akama damu. So it means to say that you derive from that that the divorce is the same as what? As ratification, the same notion. So the whole assumption is that we talk about what? Arusa. We're not speaking about nesua, marriage. So in that sense, the get is considering the same as kiyum neder, and therefore lo nitan la'afara, you cannot ratify. Amrei hacha bin su'a askinan. You have to speak about total different category, which is what? A married woman. Married woman, v'ayinu tamadein yachol leafer, that the husband cannot ratify after he ever back, mishum de'en abal mefer bekodmim. The husband cannot annul commitment that she made prior to their marriage. So meaning, if she's originally engaged and she got divorced, and then he ever back and marry her, so the husband cannot nullify the vow because the husband cannot go earlier than current marriage. So here, the same here, if she's originally married, and then she get divorced, and then she have her back and betrothed her, so you cannot annul the vow. Even the betrothed can go back to an early stage, but here, as we said on page 67b, he needs to have the partnership of the father as well. So what you see here, the Gemara is basically unresolved the question that you have here the matter of the divorce, if considering as hakama, it's a tenth mount to confirmation or not. So the Rambam, here you see a big disputation. The Rambam in Hilchot Nedarim mentioned that in chapter 11, 17, if the betrothed man heard her vow, did not nullify it, and then divorced her, and the father can no longer nullify it for her, even if she become betrothed again, the second betrothed man cannot nullify it for her. As this problem was left unresolved, here the Gemara, by ruling, is stringent with regard to uncertain situations pertaining to the Torah law. So that's the way most of the poskim hold. You see it in the Ran, you see it in the Rosh, you see it in the Rambam, and more. But there is another side, which is the Rashba. the big question is again, if the get that the arus gave is considering as a matter of kiyum, as effective, or shtika, or a matter of silence. So since in general we don't have a resolution, so it's come to Torah law, as the Rambam said, we go stringent. Now, imagine a scenario that the husband gave a get on Sunday. So that's basically considering kiyum haneder. And then he have a back. So then he cannot ratify the vow because it's considering as a kiyum. But the Ran said, the way the Rashba hold is not that way, which means that's the way Shmuel received from his teacher, that the last arus, the last betrothal, he can go ahead and ratify her vow. Why? Because the whole concept of the last one, he can go backward. Why? Because the Rashba said, get is not considering something that it's kiyum, it's approval, but shtika, but it's the same way as someone kept quiet. So therefore, the Rashba hold that the last arus, the last man, can go ahead and ratify her vow. For sure, we talk here about Bobayom that day. So again, he speaks about neder that the first arus aware of, and now the Gemara tried to bring a source from the Braita and not from other Amoraim. So I just try to be more practical in a sense. The husband come home and she said that she made some vows. So the moment he heard that, the husband have two options. Either mekayem, which means he said, okay, I approve it, or he kept quiet. So if he kept quiet and the day passed, followed the Torah, so that neder is already approved. Then, if you regret it, that day, meaning he came home, it was 10 o'clock in the morning, he heard about it, he was quiet. Now it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon, he regretted, he felt that she should not make that vow. But who knows, maybe, you know, he was, for all kind of reasons, afraid of her or afraid of somebody or whatever it is. So he go before the Torah scholar, before the Chacham, and he asks to have annulment for that vow. So if it was the same day, the Chacham can go ahead and uprooted her vow. But if it was the following day, he lost the time possibility of annulment, and therefore he cannot accept Hatarat Chacham, the sage who come and annul this vow. So the tour, very important tour, hold here, and you see it also in Tosfot, in Ketubot, that if a person made his vow on Sunday, and was, for example, at the middle of the day, and he wasn't there B'Yom Shomo, that particular day, and then several days later, he hold, oh, it's already happened, and I was quiet, so I can't do anything about it. So, meaning, again, Sunday, he heard 10 o'clock, he was quiet. Now it's 2 o'clock on Sunday, and he figure out, ah, I already approved, I can't do anything, it's over. She committed herself to something, I totally disagree, but it's over, right? So, the two hold that he can go before a sage, and this sage can uproot the vow, because it's basically that day. But Rabbi Akiva Iger elaborates on that, and he said that even you go by the way the Ran explains, that that there are situations you cannot annul vows. For example, if it was Sunday, she make her vow, the husband heard, and he said okay, he approved it, and then he regretted, and he want to annul the vow, but he cannot, for all kind of reason, he cannot find someone expert to uproot that vow. So what did he do? he go, if it's the same day, he himself can make annulment to that vow, and therefore it will not be effective. So, meaning, you don't have a manner of annulment after kiyum, after the approval of vow. But if you go several days later to a chacham to uproot that vow, so basically what happened, it's called akira lemafrea. The chacham can go and uproot it retroactively. So therefore, even it happens on Sunday, good morning, so Sunday she made a vow and then it was annulment, husband made. So even Rabbi Akiva Iger said that even according to the Ran, this neder, it's already mufar, it's already annul. 72b, the Mishnah, the concept is up to the time of the marriage, the father has the right. From that on is the husband. However, the husband cannot annul vows that happen earlier than that. So therefore, it was a minhag at that time, before they get married, to have the combination of both, the father and the husband, to have her come here and to say to her, kol nedarim she'asit, all the manner of vow that you made, it's annul. So here you have the two entities of the father and the husband. Otherwise, they cannot annul her vow. So the big question left, can they do annulment over vows that they didn't hear? So the Gemara will discuss it, because one is an example. You can send shaliach, you can send someone to do mitzvah for you, right, Eliel?
Yeah.
But can you send someone to hear the shofar for you?
No.
No. So if they did not hear her making her vow, and they not, well, yeah, right, you can't send someone to put a tefillin for you,
right,
put tzitzis for you, right?
No,
to do, to eat matzah for you, you can't have that. So if they not present when she made those vows, they didn't hear that, can they have the authority, the father and the husband, to annul vows that they're not there? So derech talmidei chachamim, the Mishnah said that the Torah scholars are example for others, that they should follow the Torah scholars. So they tried, Shita Mikubetz said, to have people follow a path of righteousness, which is to put a certain boundaries to make sure that the people not fell to those traps. So they use the term of Torah scholar, but they meant to say that others should follow that path. So they said, before she's getting married, ad shelo haita bito yotza meetzlo, since she's betrothed, but she's not totally departed from the domain of the father omer la, the father said to her, kol nedarim shenadart betoch beiti arein mufarim, all the manner of vows that you make in my domain, in my house, as long as you grew up in my domain, so it's all annul. Because the moment she get married, he cannot annul anymore her vow, even she made those vow while she was in his domain. But since she departed from his domain, he has no authority anymore over her. V'chen ha'baal, the same as a husband, newly coming husband, ad shelo tikanes lirshuto, until she moved to his domain, which means she married to him, omer la, he said to her, kol nedarim shenadart, all those matter of vow that you made from the time that we betrothed, ad shelo tikansi lirshuti, from now until we totally married, harei hen mufarin, so they're all those revoked. And mishitikanes lirshuto, for once she entered his jurisdictions, and no yachol leafer, he cannot revoke them, because that's already earlier than that. So you need the combination of the father and the husband to clear the path backward and forward. Okay? Baal Rami Bar Chama, Baal Maushi Afer Belo Shmiya. So the question applies to all kind of situations that a husband needs to be in a position to hear clearly the vow. Now, to just say, because it's a safek, so any matter of nedarim, it's mufar, it's anal, it's kind of hard, because in general, it makes a difference. The one said if it's the one who betrothed or the one who married, also father, they have to hear the vow in order to make hafara, in order to make annulment. The Beit Meir add to that, and he said, Kiyum neder, meaning approval of vow, for sure you have to have shmi'ah, you have to have a manner of hearing. But the question is, can a husband revoke vow without hearing about it? Why? Because the Torah said in the book of Bamidbar, chapter 30, Veshama Isha Davkahu, meaning the husband has to hear it clearly. Or you may say the other way, Lav Davkahu. It's better to hear, but even if he didn't hear, it's fine. So there is a book called Shiurei Rabbi Shmuel. So he asks if that's part of the right to annul the vow or not. Meaning, is the idea of hearing is a conditional or not? Anyway, Amar Rava. Rava tried to solve it from the first part of the Mishnah. Tashma. Derech talmidei chachamim ad shelo yatzat bito meetzlo. That's the way the pious people behave until the daughter did not depart from the father's domain. Omerla, he said to her, Kol nedarim shenadart betoch beiti. Any manner of vow that you have vowed in those years that you are in my house, Harehen mufarim, they all are revoked. Veha lo shama, because he did not hear it. Because if he heard it, he have to be very clear and specific and spell out this specific neder that you make, etc. But just saying, generally speaking, kol nedarim, so it means general, any time. So the Gemara rejected that, said lichi. So basically what you're saying, that even vow that he didn't hear, he can annul. So they said lichi shama hu demeifar, only when he hears of the vow, so then he can revoke it. In ken ki lo shama lama li lemeimar, so why need to say it if he didn't hear? Hakamash melan ochel tzure merabanan lahadurei. So Torah scholars, they go before the daughters and they said, all you vowed annul. And by doing so, basically the Ran explained, you encourage her to open her mouth and start telling the specification, because without hearing, it's a problem. So the moment she married, she departed from the father's domain, so he cannot do anything. So therefore, he can make that nine. Mikan uleaba as well. Tashma. So they try to solve it from our Mishnah. Miseifa. V'chena balad shelo tikanes lirshuto omer la. Which means, the moment she's in domain, he can say, all this previous one is anal, which means a person can anal the matter of vow even if he didn't hear about hear it then. Achana meda marla, the same here, the husband said to her, Lechi ishmana, your vow should be revoked when I hear about them. So the Rosh have discussion here in regards to nidrei ta'ut, if someone made a vow that is erroneous one. So if, for example, she made a vow to cause him sorrow, so is that nidrei ta'ut or not? Anyway, the Rosh have a malach there. Tashma, he will bring a proof from the upcoming Mishnah, page 75. Haomer li ishto, כל נדרים שתידורי עד שעבו ממקום פלוני, הרי הם קיימים, לא אמר כלום. So he is telling her, look, I'm planning to leave, I'm going. So all those upcoming nedarim that made until I come back, it's not in effect. So as the Rosh said, the person do not fulfill nedarim that he's not, he didn't hear about them. Because she made intent to cause him just sorrow. Haren mufarim, they're all annulled. Rabbi Eliezer Omer mufar. Rabbi Eliezer said that even you cannot make an annulment for vow that was not expressed, but you can annul it in advance before the person made. Even you cannot do hakama. So we explain veha lo shama, because since he didn't hear that vow, so how you'll be able to do it? So they said achanamei de amar lechi shmana. You see here that we have a situation. They said to her, the vow shall be revoked when I hear about them, when I return. So for example, he's leaving from this city. He's going for a whole week. He make this matter of annulment in advance. And he said, when I come back, I'll hear all the details. So the Gemara said, "Velama li min hashta?" So from that point, this matter of afara is not effect until he heard all the vows. So why he cannot have a retroactive act? Lechi shama leferla. The moment he hear that, he revoked them for her. Kasavar dilma mitridna ishada. The assumption is because he is concerned, he's committed himself to other vows, and when he heard about them, he doesn't have enough time to annul them at that time. So basically, he on Sunday wants to make Aparat Nedarim in advance on Sunday with the assumption that when he comes back on Friday. So he basically will hear the details and then he's totally make Aparat Nedarim. But the statement he made is already earlier on Sunday. Tashma. האומר לאפוטרופוס, כל נדרים שנודרת אשתי מכאן ועד שיבוא מקום פלוני אפר לה. You say to someone else, the guardian, any manner of vow that she makes from now until I come back, so you shall annul them. So it means you have a shaliach, you have an emissary to do this for him. כל נדרים שנודרת אשתי מכאן ועד שיבוא מקום פלוני אפר לה. You should annul for her all the matter of vows. And then she made a vow. והפר לה, יכול יהיו מופרים. תלמוד לומר, אישה יקימנו ואישה יפירנו. רבי יושיעיה. אמר לו רבי יונתן, מצאים בכל התורה כולה ששלוחו של אדם כמותו. You see the Gemara in Kiddushin 41-42 said that if you have an emissary, it's like the person himself. He's saying, so you can, so the famous Ksot HaChoshen, the Ksot HaChoshen ask, you can make cannot make a shaliach to hear the sound of the shofar. The same way you cannot, as Eliot mentioned, you cannot pay for someone who hear the shofar for you, or eat matzah on Pesach for you, and put the filling for you. You have to do it. So the same here, you cannot have a shaliach to listen, right? The situation came to him with someone who was a vow, and he said, "Areat mekudeshet." So that's basically the famous Rosh question, because if you got about Tumot Masot, you do have a shaliach. There is certain things you can have shaliach. So, אפילו רבי ישוע כאמר לא, אלא משום דיוק זה הכתוב הוא, אישה יקימנו ואישה יפירנו,
אבל בכולי אלמה שלוחו של אדם כמותו ועל השמיע לב. Which means, in this situation, the husband will not hear of the vows before he annulled them. So it means that annulment of the vows, it's not depend upon the husband hear about it. So it means you can make hafarat nedarim, you can make annulment of the vows. You can make annulment of vows. So the whole question, the some poskim the Ran, it's a few luminary rabbis, the issue of the vow. The way that it's expressed, it's very broader question. Let's say you have mitzvot, to eat matzah on Pesach. So what do? You eat matzah on Pesach and you yourself need to eat. Can you send someone else to eat for you? No. The same shofar. You have a mitzvah to hear the shofar. So can you send someone else to hear the shofar for you? No. So if that's the case, so you send someone to this type of situation that to do something for you, to hear vows. So it's a problem. The Avnei Nezer and Chelkat Yoav elaborates, and they say that when it's come to the shofar, you have two separate mitzvot. One is shmi'at ha-shofar, to hear the sound of the shofar independently, and one is a tkiat shofar, that you have to have a bar chiyuva, you have to have someone who is not a minor, who is not a who is part of our faith, to do the tkiat shofar, which means you can do annulment without hearing. Here is the proof.
Page 73, Hachana me de'amar la lechi shamana meifar la. So, or meifer la. Meaning, this is Sunday. I may come back on Friday and I will be so occupied. So he said to her, the husband said to her, said to the guardian, to administrator, he said, when I hear about the vow, upon my return, revoke them for her. So lechi shama lefer lahu. So it means, why you need a guardian to do that if the effects will take place only when the husband come back? So he said, I'll be so preoccupied at that time, he's so busy, so I will not remember to do it. But you see here, the whole question we posted, if the father and the husband can annul vows, didn't hear, it didn't solve. I like to conclude, there is a book called Betzel HaChochma. In that book, he asked a question, if someone sent a shaliach, an emissary, to betroth the woman. As you know, part of the minhagim is that the time of the chatunah is a fest. We fast. It's a matter of fact that 30 years ago, when I got married, was the Rosh Chodesh, was Lamed Sivan. But usually, we fast. There is a source for that that says, Vayikach et machalat bat Yishmael. So we derive from the word machala is mechila. So they said, Chatan dome lemelech, etc. So the whole idea is that the time of the wedding, it's a new chapter, the sin, the iniquities be forgiven. So the question is, when you send someone else, as the Gemara said, to betroth a woman for you, so who needs to fast? The shaliach or meshaleach, the one who sent, or the emissary? So the Betzel HaChochma said that it all depends upon the reason for fasting. If you tell me the whole idea is the teshuva, that basically is a new chapter, is the open, the like Yom Kippur, it's a new one. So therefore, the meshaleach, the one who sent it. Why? As we say, en shaliach l'dvar aveira. he is not the emissary to anything to clean up his sins. So therefore, it's the one who meshalech, the one who sent it. But if you say that the whole reason is halot kiddushin, the whole reason is to make this matter of betrothed effective. So therefore, it's a proper for the shaliach, for the agent, to fast and not the meshalech. So they have a big discussion over that. It's a book called Betzel HaChokhmah.
Shuloim alachai, shuloim alachai.